Next item will be the vector product. Vector product of vectors. In order to define this vector product, we need some auxiliary constructions, and we need the concept of orientation of triple of vectors. So before learning the vector product, we introduce some auxiliary concept. Orientation of triples of vectors. Assume that we have three vectors which are not in one plane. So their configuration is spatial, not planar. Let's draw them. Two of them are drawn so that they have the common initial point. We denote it through O. And these two vectors can be placed in some plane. And then the third vector is not in this plane. Let's assume that these three vectors are ordered. So we can say that one of them is the first vector, the second of them is the second vector, and the third is the third vector. So we shall enumerate them. Say this is A1, this is A2, and this is A3. Then the ordered triple of vectors A1, A2, A3 is called right triple if when observing from the end of the third vector, A3, the shortest rotation from the first vector A1 to the second vector A2 is counterclockwise. So, look at the picture. This is the first vector. We can rotate it towards the second vector. And there are two ways to rotate the first vector towards the second vector. We can rotate in this direction, or we can rotate in opposite direction. But this rotation is shorter, so we choose the shortest rotation, and we look from the end of the third vector. So the direction of looking at this picture is from the end of the third vector. And if we see this rotation as if it happened counterclockwise, do you understand this word? Counterclockwise.
Yes, doctor.
This is if you take a watch, then the rotation is against the rotation of arrows in your watch. I can demonstrate it using this device. So here this arrow is rotate clockwise, but if you rotate in this direction, this would be counterclockwise. So I hope it's clear. And if you look here, this rotation is counterclockwise. If you see on it from the end of the third vector, but if you look at this rotation from downward, from below this plane, then you see it as it as if it happens clockwise. So there are two sorts of triples of vectors, which are not coplanar. Right triple and left triple. Right triple is that which is defined above, and other triples which are not right triple are left triples. So I hope you understand this concept. And now we can proceed to defining the vector product. Assume that we have two vectors A and B, and let's draw them so that they have common initial point. This is a vector A and this is a vector B. Their vector product will be denoted using square brackets. This vector product will be some new vector C, which should be defined. This vector C is defined through the following three conditions. The vector product of two vectors A and B is a third vector C, which is defined by the following three conditions. First condition says that the vector C is perpendicular to the vector A and C is perpendicular to the vector B. So this third vector should be perpendicular to both of them. And if we draw the plane of these two vectors, then the third vector C should be perpendicular to the plane of these two vectors, because it is perpendicular to A and B simultaneously. So it should be in this line, which is perpendicular to B and which is perpendicular to A. Having this line is called the perpendicular to the plane, where the vectors A and B are placed. We should choose the direction of this vector C. It should be, it can be directed upward, or it can be directed downward. And we should choose one of these two directions. This choice is given by the following second condition. Vectors A, B, C form a right triple. So this vector C should be chosen in such a way that complemented with the vectors A and B, it should form a right triple. Let's look at the picture. If you look from upward to down, so assume that we stay here and look downward, and look at the shortest rotation from A to B. And if you look from upward to downward, then we see it counterclockwise. And if you look from below the plane, then we shall see this rotation as if it happened clockwise. So we need that it should be to be counterclockwise. Therefore, our observation should be from above the plane. Therefore, the vector C, the direction of vector C, should be chosen upward. If you have, if we have the line where the vector is placed, and if we have chosen the direction of this vector, the last is to define it completely is is to have its length. So the third condition gives us the formula for the length of C. The modulus, or the length of the vector C, is equal to the product of the modulus of A and modulus of B multiplied by the sine of the angle phi, where phi is the angle between the vectors A and B. So these three conditions defines the vector C uniquely. This is a geometric description or geometric construction for the vector product. What is the difference of the vector product and the scalar product? If you take the scalar product A and B, then this scalar product is a number. And if you take vector product A and B, then this vector product is a vector. This is a difference between scalar and vector product. And vector product is denoted using square brackets. In some countries and in some books, the vector product is denoted using the cross sign. So we can write A cross B. And in this case, it is called cross product. But I don't like this way, because the multiplication signs in the form of a cross is used in many other cases. For example, you can look at here. This is a table of multiplication for numbers. So here also the cross product is used. So using the cross multiplication sign is not very convenient when applied to vectors. I prefer this this notation using square brackets and the comma sign as the multiplication sign. Now let's proceed to properties of the vector product. Properties. Properties of the vector product. We shall select four properties, which will be said basic properties. Let's start with the first of them. If you multiply the vector A by the vector B, it is equal to the product of vector B by A, but with the opposite sign. So if you exchange these two vectors within the vector product, then the sign of the vector product changes. You have minus here. This property is called anti-commutativity. Anti-commutativity. Then the properties number 2 and number 3 are similar to the corresponding properties of the scalar product. So, for example, if you have a1 plus a2 and this sum is multiplied by b, this is equal to a1 multiplied by b plus a2 multiplied by b. The third property is the following. If you take some number alpha multiplied by the vector A and then you multiply it vectorially by the vector B, this is equal to alpha times A multiplied by B. These two properties are called linearity. Linearity of the vector product. And the fourth property says that A is multiplied by B. A multiplied by B is equal to zero if and only if A is parallel to B. So the product of parallel vectors is zero. And if the product of two vectors is zero, then these vectors are parallel. So these two conditions are equivalent. Therefore, testing the vector product by for being zero is a test for parallelity of two vectors. For us, these two properties will be the most important. Look at the property of linearity. Here, the sum of two vectors and the product of a vector by a number are in the first multiplicand, so they are placed before comma. Before comma here and before comma here. However, you can rewrite these two properties in the following way. You can write B and then A1 plus A2. This will be equal to B multiplied by A1 plus B multiplied by A2. And similarly, you can write B multiplied by alpha A is equal to alpha times B multiplied by A. These two properties are also linearity, but they are not listed here because these two properties can be derived from these two properties using the property number one. So these two properties follow from the properties 2 and 3. Then our next topic is it is entitled as calculation of the vector product of two vectors through their coordinates to their coordinates in some basis. Calculations of the vector product of two vectors through their coordinates in some basis. Assume that we choose some basis. A basis in this space is a triple of vectors E1, E2, E3. Typically, we draw the bases like three vectors with a common beginning, with a common initial point, and since it is basis, and the bases in this space should not be coplanar, so these three vectors do not lie on the same plane. So if I draw the plane comprising two of them, the third vector should be outside this plane. Typically, an arbitrary basis is not orthogonal. These vectors should not be perpendicular. They are absolutely arbitrary. Therefore, we say that we choose a skew angular basis. Skew angular basis. Saying skew angular basis, we assume that we choose an arbitrary basis with no special conditions for its vectors. And then let's take two vectors A and B. A and B. Since we have a basis, we can expand these two vectors using this basis. So we can write A is equal to A1 times E1 plus A2 times E2 plus A3 times E3. And similarly for B. B is equal B1 times E1 plus B2 times E2 plus B3 times E3. A1, A2, A3 are coordinates. And B1, B2, B3 are also coordinates. All of them are numbers. So we have these two expansions of a vector A and the vector of the vector A and the vector B in the bases E1, E2, E3. For making this formula shorter, we use this summation sign. So we write A is equal to the sum with the summation index I, which runs from 1 to 3. Then we put the coordinates A with the index I as an upper index. And this coordinate is multiplied by the vector E sub I. So this formula and this formula are the same, but they are written differently. And for the vector B, we have B is equal to the sum, where the summation index J runs from 1 to 3, B J multiplied by the basis vector E sub J. So now we shall calculate the vector product A by B. Having this formula, I shall substitute this formula in place of A. So this will be the sum I for, which runs from 1 to 3, A sub I multiplied by E sub I, and then this is multiplied by B. Now let's apply some properties of the vector product to this formula. Let's look to the list of our properties. Let's look at the property of linearity. Here I have the summation sign, the plus, inside the square brackets, and this summation sign is outside the square brackets. So this formula can be understood as a rule letting us to bring this summation sign from inside the square brackets to outside the square brackets. In this case, the summation sign is inside the brackets. Due to the property number 2, we can bring this summation sign outside the brackets. So I can write the summation sign first and then the square brackets A with the index I multiplied by E with index I and then multiplied vectorially by the vector B. Now look at this factor. It is a number. A with the index I is a coordinate. Coordinates are numbers. So A with the index I is a number. Now let's look at the property number 3. Here alpha is a number. And this number, which is initially inside the square brackets, can be written outside the square brackets. So it is brought from inside to outside. Similarly, in this place, I can bring this factor, this coefficient, from inside the brackets to outside the brackets. And the resulting formula will be this sum with respect to the index I, which runs from 1 to 3, A with the index I multiplied by the square brackets E sub I, which is multiplied by the vector B. So I have used this formula and I have derived this formula. The next step is to substitute this formula, the second formula, the formula for B, in place of B in our calculations. So we proceed. We write the sum with respect to I from 1 to 3, A with index I, then the square brackets E with the index I, then comma, and then I shall write the sum with respect to the index J, which runs from 1 to 3, B with index J multiplied by the vector E with index J. Now we need to do the same things with this sum and with this coefficient as we have done with this sum and this coefficient. Therefore, let's look at these two formulas. In these formulas, the summation sign, the plus sign, initially is inside the brackets and finally it is outside the brackets. And note that this plus sign is after the comma. So it is in the second multiplicand, which is after the comma sign here. And similarly, this coefficient alpha, which goes from inside to outside the square brackets, is after the comma sign in this formula. Let's compare with the expressions that we have obtained. In this expression, the sum sign is after the comma and it is inside square brackets. My goal is to bring this summation sign outside the square brackets. Let's do it. So this is equal to this sum is copied, this coefficient is also copied, and then this sum is brought from inside to outside. So then I write the second summation sign with respect to J from 1 to 3, and upon moving it from inside to outside, within the square brackets, I would have E sub I, then comma, then B sub J multiplied by E sub J. Note that this coefficient, this is a coordinate. Look, this is a coordinate. And all coordinates are numbers. Therefore, B sub J is a number. And the number can be brought from inside the square brackets to outside the square brackets because of the property which we considered which we considered here because of this property. So using this property, I write the summation sign I with which runs from 1 to 3, then the coefficient a sub I, then another summation sign g from 1 to 3, then I move this bj to this position. So I write bj, and in square brackets I would have e sub I multiplied by e sub j. Then when we multiply some numeric coefficient to the sum of several terms, it is equivalent if I multiply this numeric coefficient by each term in the sum and then perform summation. So I can move this summation sign one step forward. And as a result, I would have double summation with respect to the index I, which runs from 1 to 3, and with respect to the index j, which runs from 1 to 3. Then two coefficients a, I, b, j, which then is multiplied by the vector product of two basis vector e sub I and e sub j. So this is that very formula which I needed. Let's copy it in an ultimate form. We started from the expression a, which is multiplied by b, and we have obtained this formula. Let's take it into the box, which says that it's our desired formula. Using this formula, we can calculate the vector products through the coordinates of two vectors a and b, and through the basis vectors. This formula is related to a skew angular basis. What is the difficulty of using this formula? The difficulty is in this term. We cannot compute this value algebraically. We need to draw the vectors in some chart. So we need them to be visible, to be drawn, to be made of some material. So we need these vectors as physical beings, as not as signs, not as writings, but in their natural occurrence. So once you have three vectors e1, e2, e3, you can multiply e1 by e2, e1 by e3. So what will be if you multiply e1 by e2? That would be a vector perpendicular to E1 and E2. So this will be E1 by E2. If you multiply E2 by E3, this will be the vector like this, which is perpendicular to both of them. And this will be the vector E2 by E3. And if you multiply E3 by E1, you will have the vector like this. So these three vectors are different from E1, from E2, and from E3. So in place of three initial basis vectors, we would have three other vectors, which are vector products. Therefore, this expansion is an expansion in with respect to some other three vectors, which are different from the initial basis. And therefore, it's difficult to use this formula practically. What we need to do in order to simplify this formula? We use the concept of expansion. Any vector in this space can be expanded in a basis. So for example, if we take the case where I is equal to 1 and j is equal to 2, for example, A E1 is multiplied by E2. The result is a vector. And since this is a vector, it can be expanded in a basis. So we can write E1 multiplied by E2 is equal some coefficient C1 multiplied by E1 plus some coefficient C2 multiplied by E2 plus some coefficient C3 multiplied by E3. Similarly, if you have the product E2 by E3, you can write that this is also a vector. And therefore, you can write a similar expansion. So you can write C1 by E1 plus C2 by E2 plus C3 by E3. Here, C1, C2, C3 are some numbers. C1, C2, C3 here are also some numbers. But these numbers should not coincide with these three numbers. And because this C1, C2, C3 are different from this one, we can set some signs saying they are different. Here we multiply the vector E1 by E2. Therefore, I shall put below two indices, 1 and 2. This 1 and 2 say me that I multiply E1 by E2. And here also I put two numbers, E1 and 2. 1 and 2. Here I multiply E2 by E3. Therefore, below the coefficient C1, I set the mark 2 and 3. 2 and 3. 2 and 3. And I can do in this way, in the similar way, for any combination of two indices. So if instead of 1 and 2 or 2 or 3, I set letters. So if I set E sub I and E sub J, I can write the similar formula. But instead of 1 and 2 or 2 or 3, here I should set letters C I J and upper index 1 is multiplied by E1 plus Cij2 multiplied by E2 plus C ij3 multiplied by e3. Writing in this way, I replace several formulas of this sort by one formula of this sort. And because here I have two summation signs, plus and plus, I can use instead of them one summation sign in the form k, with the index k which runs from 1 to 3, and I write c I j k multiplied by e k. Indeed, if k equals to 1 here and here, I have this term. If k is equal to 2, then I have this term. And if k is equal to 3, I will have this term. And all these three terms are combined together with the summation sign. So they are added to each other. And instead of this formula, I have the formula e with index I. When multiplied vectorially by e with index j, the result is this sum. The coefficients here are numeric constants. C, I, j, k are numeric constants. How many numeric constants I have in this formula? Since I runs from 1 to 3, j runs from 1 to 3, and k runs from 1 to 3, totally I have 3 by 3 by 3, which is equal to 27 different numbers. These 27 numbers constitute an array. Is an array of numbers. C, I, J, K, C, I, J, K is an array of numbers. And now I shall use this formula in order to simplify this formula. So I will substitute this expression in place of this square bracket in this formula. A is multiplied by B, and this is equal to double sum I runs from 1 to 3, J runs from 1 to 3, A with the index I, B with the index J. And in place of this formula, I will put this sum with respect to k, which runs from 1 to 3, c, I, j, k, multiplied by e, k. According to general rules of working with sums, if I multiply some sum by some numeric number, numeric coefficients, it's equivalent if I multiply each summand by this numeric coefficient and then perform summation. So therefore I can move this sum sign forward, and as a result I would get the formula with three sums. I, which runs from 1 to 3, j, which runs from 1 to 3, k, which runs from 1 to 3. And after them, I shall have a with index I, B with index J, C I J K multiplied by E K. And this is the expression for A multiplied by B. Looking at this formula, we see that the product of two vectors is expressed through the coordinates of these two vectors and is presented in the form of the sum expanded in the same as the vectors A and B. This is the formula for general skew angular basis. For the general skew angular basis. The coefficients here, C, I, J, K, characterize the basis E1, E2, E3. It's some characteristic for a basis. This coefficient, this constants are called structure constants. Of the basis E1, E2, E3. So we have obtained the formula for the vector product through the structure constant of a general skew angular basis. Now, yet, we have no tools for calculating these constants. In order to calculate them, I need to have the bases E1, E2, E3 realized in the form of some So they should be made of a material. It should be presented in their physical being in order to have the opportunity to find this structure constants. Further, we shall try to express the structure constants through some more simple objects. And this will be successful, but this will take some effort from us. Now let's proceed from skew angular basis toward the orthonormal basis. We know that orthonormal bases are more simple than general skew angular bases, and I hope, and we hope, that in an orthonormal basis, this formula also will be more simple than in general case. Let's study structure constant of an orthonormal basis.